praise you, Holy Spirit. Praise you, Father. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. 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 God, Father, praise and glory, glorify you. For each of us who are gathered in your name, and lift up your hands, every soul who needs your holy presence, every man, woman, longing for your touch, everyone in whose life you want to enter. Father, we raise up into your hands every one of these persons. We ask you right now to come into our hearts, to take hold of us, and give us a true experience of you. And through that experience, Lord, lead us into the knowledge of you, that we can listen to you, hear you, and follow you. Be with us, Lord, with these wonderful moments where we can gaze upon you, let us imagine for them. Stay with us, remain with us. Your sisters and brothers, as anyone is talking about that woman, I thought probably people from there, we have a very, very beautiful story in John chapter 4 and John chapter 5. John chapter 4 speaks about this woman who was a sinner, as we know. And then we have in John chapter 5, we have a story of a man who was paralyzed for 38 years. John's gospel, when you read, you must remember that there are 1, 2, 3 layers of meaning. There are many, many layers of meaning that are there. So, what is John trying to teach us? First of all, and that's what we look at. I really love something that you said, that God loves us so much that He wants to come into our life, not because of His love, but the person that is coming because of His love. And you would see that there is a lot of things that happen to us purely because of God's love. And I probably think that this little incident that we were all looking at, that is the story of this woman. And then we have in John chapter 4 or 5, the man paralyzed for 8 years. That is, since we're touching John chapter 4, let us skip to John chapter 5. In John chapter 5, Jesus comes to Jerusalem and he encounters a man who was paralyzed for 38 years. And then Jesus asks him this one question: do you want to be healed? And I guess if any of you are asked, or any of us are asked, do you want to be healed, we would surely say, yes, Lord, we want to be healed. But this man says something very, very strange. He makes a complaint about others. He says, there is no one here to take me to this pool. And you know that pool where the inter family would come back and stir the water, and the first one when they let him restore him, they would be healed. Now he said, there is nobody. When Jesus asks him, do you want to be healed? He should have responded, I want. This man complains about what others are not going to be. In fact, the scripture says all along about this man that he has only complaints. And this is a very, very strange thing that will happen, that there is only complaints after complaints that will come out of his mouth. One after the other. First, he would come very, very nicely, and then he is there, he's in the corner, and tells him, would you like to be healed? The question that answer that anyone would have expected is this: the Bible is very clear, unlike the man in John chapter 9, where the blind man born blind, and he asks, why is he blind? And is it because of the sins of others? When Jesus meets him in the temple, he says, has an implication. His suffering is due to because of his sin. Now, this man, if he had an issue, instead of admitting his sin, like this man and woman, he's blaming others. This is all that he does. Now, why did John talk about this verse? Why did he take it? I'm not going to go much into it. We have always studied in the scripture that the Israelites roamed around the desert for 40 years. But the scriptures call it in Deuteronomy chapter 2, 14. It did tell that the time that they roamed around, because they did not show faith in God, that's Deuteronomy 1, is 38 years. The Bible does not want to go into years, for example.
Time is coming when you neither worship on this mountain or the other mountain.
Whereas in chapter 4, 5, the one was supposed to know. This man, Bible said, he didn't even know who it was that he knew. I have always asked this question. This man is compiling for everybody. Why would God come and beg him? In fact, God healed him. Even when he comes, God should take it and heal. If I were in this place, you know what I would have done? Because he deserved to be crowned the one, not that he. But God is kind. God in chapter 5, verse 8 says this words. God, because of his love, to prove his love, what did he do? Even while he was still in sin, he sent his beloved son who died for us, at the expiation for our sin. Even while he was still in sin, God. It has nothing to do with my goodness. It has all to do with whose goodness? God's goodness. Purely God is love. It does not do my goodness. Many people think because good things happen to them, it is because of our goodness. This is where we are. God is kind, both good and bad. God will be a father, he will send blessings to both good and this way, that is for only bad people or good people. So, God loves everyone. Just because good things happen, it's not an approval of your goodness. Then how do I know that God is talking about my goodness? For that I need to ask whether God is happy with you. There is a difference between God's love for you and whether God can pursue you. Yeah. people through evil, he will blame whom? Evil. Chief evil. When he asks, if you do this, chief evil, he can still blame the snake. Fortunately, God will not give a chance for whom? The snake to be justified. You will find the same issue in 1 Samuel chapter 15. When Saul is asked, why did he disobey? He should have made a mistake, he will blame the people for it. What are the psychological today, when people are complaining about it, you say, oh, because my wife said this, her husband said, therefore I got it. And that is a justification. Therefore, you are actually going to make an excuse for yourself. This is one of the things that happened to many people. And this is the issue with that man, Father of the Lord. He will never have to blame others. People in his life always blame God. They found fault with God, they found fault with Moses, they found fault with everything in themselves. Today we have this issue. And this is the one. Because when you find fault with others, our eyes are not on God, our eyes are on who? Other people are making a mistake. And by focusing on them, we will continue to mistake because if he gets out of the fight, if he gets in fight, if he falls major and fight, make a mistake. And therefore, we can justify our and we become not only with guilty about it. And this is the tendency we have. These are the three steps which we require to turn any encounter, any experience of God to a knowledge of God. That is why this woman will come to know who Jesus is, but the other man will not come to know, and that is disaster. If talking about Israel, the people of Judea, the people of Jesus came, they will never recognize him. Because they didn't have humility, they didn't have sincerity, they didn't have mistake, rather than blame others for the mistakes. But at this woman, humility and truthfulness, and then, when you have come to the knowledge of God, what should you do? What did the woman do? She went and did what? Christ did for her for us. This is called when you think of what did Christ do in the will of God. When you have received, you must give. What you have freely received, you must give. And that is she gave the jar of the people to be filled. And then she goes and what? Gives to others exactly what she received and not others back. This is the beauty that I think is given to the people of the living God. When you receive, you want the graces to multiply, you want that to give to others. Otherwise, the graces will not grow. The more you give, the more you receive. And we must give our attention as you go. You need to understand what spirits you have, this you must go and share with others. And then encourage the others to bring them. If you do not do this, you will see those graces will remain stuck there. It will not grow. This sharing and giving is what will make it truly happen. And there they become what they want. When you do this, it is God who is working. Look at that word, the power of the woman's word. When she has a married woman, a single woman, when they told people, all the men in the village, surprisingly, they only her God. How is she going to power of that word? Because Christ and the Holy Spirit is the one that is working. What did Jesus say? When you do the work that I do, I will come and dwell in you, my spirit will come and my power will come. When the Holy Spirit is in her, and that word is power, immediately God comes. When whatever you have received from God, when you will give it to the church, you will see the power of God's power. And that's where they grow people to Christ. And then finally people will say, a woman is not because of you said, I initiate it, but finally because of what? We answer to the experience. We need to lead others to experience the same thought. This is the work that is given to all of us. I know most of us are the other ones, and I guess we have a job. It is not even to keep Christ with us. We must say, if you are going to see, then you will see the truth. And that is what God is asking us to do. Let us truly ask the good Lord truly to bless us, to anoint us, that we will have these four wonderful characteristics. The first characteristic is what we call as the beauty of this wonderful character, humility. To come before the Lord in all our sufferings, aspect of our life of charismatic person shares with others. It comes across. That same stuff that you and I have received, this knowledge we have received, put into action and get it. That's what God has asked of us. Today, I will ask you, sisters and brothers, tomorrow the church here in Manchester, they have this. The small Christian communities having their national Indian convention, and there is almost 6,000 of them, 6,000 gathering. We pray for all of them. These are people who are from so many places, and let God bless me and we all. Let's also pray for our own parents, our own families, including the ones who are away from God. So many who have never known God. So many are living in sin and not admitting their own fault. So many are finding simple difficult to accept that mistake because the pain that others have caused is so strong, they are able to see God. Till they render with their mistake, they can never count on God. Let's truly understand that unless we get to picture Christ in Christ, we can never picture Him. Otherwise, our problem will be on the evil of others, and finally, we have to do the same thing that they have been doing, and then we can. And we need to turn our eyes back to Him. Let's pray for Him all these things today as we look at these two wonderful people, and through these wonderful people, we look at the entire and Samaria, and the land of India, which is the God chosen people. And let's pray that in so much time we are, let's turn our experience of God into a knowledge of God, to know Him first. And once we know Him, we cannot believe in Him. And once we believe in Him, we need to show it by His words. That's what God wants of us. Let's not just take pleasure in the fact that God loves us. We need to make sure that God delights in us. Every evening before we go to bed, ask this question, Jesus, are you happy with me? Then, yes, we are right. So we will now stand up and picture that God every person in our life, only for this gift, that all of us has been the healing touch of God. And through us, may this healing touch of God spread to all our parents, all our family members, especially to all those who need the healing touch, the deliverance of God from the bondages of sin. One aspect that we pray for especially today, the deliverance of the bondages of sin, that all they can recognize the blindness will be removed, the deafness, the hardness of heart will be removed. If you see Christ, if you are small, and that way they can move on to reach out to others. So we will all stand up right now, and I ask the Father to come up and pray for you with a prayer as we sing again.
Thank you. dynamic of God.